You are listening to CPA Review, and more you are listening to CPA Review, and more you are listening to CPA Review, and more you are listening to CPA Review, and more. Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, wherever you're joining from. And thank you for listening to this episode of CPA Review and More with your host, Phil Yeager. I'm your producer and director here at the Yeager Studios, Rob Medford, and together we are bringing you the number one podcast for CPAs and CPA candidates. If you're new to the show, I'd like to be the first to thank you for checking us out. We're excited to have you as part of our listenership. If you're here because you've already heard our show and you're a continued listener, we thank you for the ongoing support. It's always greatly appreciated. If you're in the market for a CPA review course or simply want to know more about what Yeager CPA Review has to offer, check out our website at yeagercpareview.com or call our office and we'll answer any questions you might have. The link and telephone number will be in the description of this episode. Here at Team Yeager, we're excited to tell you about our new Yeager CPA Review subscription format. It's the same great Yeager CPA Review course that you know and love on an all-new month-to-month, no long-term commitment subscription format. But without any further delay, I'm going to pass the microphone on over to your host, Billy Yeager.
Well, thank you very much, Rob. And today on CPA Review and More, which is the podcast name, we have with us Alina. Now, Alina, I didn't ask you how you pronounce your second name. All right. How do you pronounce that?
Nikishina.
Is that Polish? What is that?
It's Russian.
Russian. Well, I was close to it.
Pretty
right?
close. Polish. Yeah.
Okay. And you are, first of all, you won an award. When did you win that award for the influencers?
So they give that in the summer. So yeah, just this summer.
You just got it this summer. And where did they give this presentation? Is there a place you went to?
No, not for the influencer award. So CPA Practice Advisor every year has either a 40 under 40. And in conjunction with that, there's a kind of a 20 under 40 for people who are not in the public accounting industry practicing as CPAs anymore, but are influencing the industry. So
you're in that group?
Yeah. And so the 40 under 40 individuals, they actually get to go to Indianapolis every year and have an amazing think tank discussion with the group. But the 20 under 40 people don't get to go. So, and for since 2016, I've actually been honored with this award in 16, 17, and 18. And I got to go to Indianapolis, which was just incredible.
To a think tank?
Yes.
Yeah, I don't like to go to think tanks. I can't swim. That wasn't even funny. But anyway... Did you like that one?
Oh,
yeah, just humor.
Amazing.
Me. All right. Thank you very much. So who do you influence as far as you got this award for being an influencer? What do you do as an influencer?
Sure. So our goal at the Mastery Network, which is the business that I'm building, and I think the reason why I received this award, is because we want to impact the accounting industry by giving accountants an easier way to bring advisory services into their practices. So currently, as you're aware, and like we discussed, there's a big shift happening in the accounting industry with technology coming in and automating kind of the bread and butter services, you know, the taxes and bookkeeping that were once done very manually, right? And now we have, you know, cloud technology like QuickBooks Online and Xero, and tax software that's actually able to automate a lot of that work. And so everyone is talking about how important advisory is, right? Consulting, you have to build deeper relationships with your clients. And there's a lot of discussion around that, right? But very rarely do you actually have action steps on what you can do. And so the Mastery Network is creating a tool that would actually allow you to put a system into place and kind of giving you the how.
How'd you learn to do this? I mean, you have a master's degree in what, taxation or accounting?
Yep, that's right.
All right, so how did you become a person that could do this type of function for accounting firms? You must have some knowledge in consulting.
So my career began at Deloitte, and I worked there for about 4.5 years. Just doing tax work. And I decided to kind of look for a firm that worked with a different type of client, I wanted to feel a little bit more connection with my clients. So I always kind of wanted to work with entrepreneurs and small business owners. So I knew I needed to look for a smaller kind of local firm. And so I found a firm where I was able to do just that. And I was able to be in a lot of, I kind of got to wear a lot of different hats. You know, it wasn't just kind of being only the accountant. I was helping run the firm as well. And so when I was doing that, I was actually learning about small business ownership and entrepreneurship as I was talking to my clients, as I was sitting in that seat, right? And I did that for about almost 4.5 years. So I gained this knowledge that you need, kind of the basic foundational knowledge that you need to be able to run a business, manage a business properly.
This is your full-time job right now?
It is. Mm-hmm.
And you're trying to bring advisory services to firms who actually a lot of the services they used to do are being done by the client, like write-up work, bookkeeping work, right? A lot of firms used to do a lot of that stuff. That was actually the bread and butter, and also tax return.
Absolutely. And it still is, actually. I think that, you know, this industry has, you know, a little bit of years left, but everyone is talking about how technology at this point is now exponentially growing and innovating, right?
It's 2019, all right? How many people are still, how many accounting firms, small firms are still doing write-up work? Or is the client now doing all that information, feeding it in? No, they're not.
A lot of accounting firms are still doing that work. I think that clients are getting smarter with technology. So back when QuickBooks first came out, I think, you know, just hearing people talk that were, I wasn't around back then to see it myself. Hearing people talk about how, oh my gosh, clients are now going to do their own bookkeeping. We're no longer going to be needed. And what happened was, is that you still have to understand how the software kind of works, you know, the mechanics around it, in order to do it properly, right? So anybody can enter in a transaction, but how do they know if they classified it properly? What if they made a mistake, right? And I saw that working with small business owners a lot. It's like, you know, for example, they would have a shareholder distribution, right? And they would take money from the bank that they earned, and they would put that as an expense on the P&L. And it's like, oh, look, I have $10 of profit that I now have to pay taxes on. I'm like, nope, well, we take that expense and we put it on the balance sheet where it belongs. And now you have, you know, this $50,000 that you have to pay taxes on. So I think that technology is getting smarter. They understand what mistakes people usually make. And they, you know, have little things that pop up that say, hey, are you sure? Because I think it might be this. So as technology progresses, as people get smarter with how to use it, that's kind of when we'll start to see more services focused on advisory of like, how do you use the software and what happens now, and less of like, let me do it for you.
Now that's one form, advisory services, right?
I would say so. Absolutely.
What other advisory services would you be showing these companies?
So I'm not showing software and technology necessarily advisory, but.
But all right. Someone comes to you for consulting. Mm-hmm. All right.
Yeah.
What services do they want from you?
Yeah. So the tool that we're building is e-learning. So e-learning for anybody that wants to advance their business knowledge. And currently we have a program called Core 24. It's kind of the 24 basic foundational topics that one should understand if they want to be in business. So how to run and manage a business, anything from smart planning to how to read financial statements to how to pay yourself, hire employees or contractors, sales and marketing, and soft skills like leadership, communication. So accountants can use this tool to give to their clients, and their clients can learn these foundational basic concepts and then ask really smart questions. Because something that I've gotten when I was researching this business is that, you know, sometimes clients don't know what they don't know, so they don't know to ask.
Right.
And I've seen my own clients do something that cost them a lot of money or time, and they didn't tell me until afterwards. And I asked them, you know, why didn't you say something? And they would say, I didn't know to ask you. I didn't know that it was important.
Are you doing advisory services, this e-learning for accountants? For the clients themselves? Can you explain to me how this works just very quickly?
Yeah. So I create e-learning that focuses on basic business concepts. Right.
And who gets those basic, who are you teaching those basic business concepts to?
So I have a person in mind that may not be business savvy at all. So I use really simple terms. I use, you know, English, not technical professional advisor speak. And this e-learning is then licensed to a professional advisor to then sub-license to their client. But this professional advisor can also use this tool as a training tool with their team.
What can I do with this e-learning? All right. Can I advise them on what? Tell me what I want to advise them on that I'm not doing it right now.
Right. Well, you probably are doing it right now is the thing. However, okay, it is hard to charge for those simple conversations when someone calls you up and says quick question. And maybe it is a quick question. You give them a 10-15 minute answer, but the value of that is tremendous because of your years of experience. And but you normally you don't charge for that. There are some accounting professionals that do, and it's amazing. Personally, and other people that I know as well in this community have a lot of hard time charging for those conversations. So this is a way for you to charge, yes.
Most accountants are not salesmen, right?
Right.
We're not salesmen. So how do we sort of dance around this so that now we're telling our client who we've had for 10 years and we've given them all the time in the world on the phone that now we have to charge for our time because of what? The e-learning system?
So you actually make a really good point. We are recommending to our members to start selling this to new clients, because it's going to be easier to sell it to new clients than existing ones, like you said, that you've been giving free advice to for years and years. However, I do think that this is going to lead to more conversations that you can charge for, because when they do call you and say, hey, quick question, you give them the answer and then you say, hey, I have this program that I actually just, you know, became a member of, and it will teach you every, you know, kind of the basics, including the questions that you just asked.
You say,
so this program can actually teach you the question that you just asked, give you the answer to the question you just asked, but also a lot more basic questions that business owners have asked throughout the years.
Yeah, I think in a lot of cases, I guess you could present this concept to your existing clients and just say to them, all I sell is my time, and I've been very gracious over the years, but now, you know, I have to sell my time for my time. That's really all I have is selling time.
Yeah.
Right. So I'm going to, you know, and you don't obviously say I'm going to charge you $500 an hour or whatever, but I'm going to, you know, come up with a fair fee. All right. To charge you for 15 minutes of talk. And I can't imagine any client of the CPA saying that's unfair. All right.
Yeah.
Because, right.
Absolutely.
You don't deal with objections that the clients make when they bring up these concepts of, you know, I'm going to charge you for my time. All right. Do you deal with?
I've gotten them as an accountant. I've definitely gotten some. I think I've gotten a question before from a client.
All right.
You know, hey, quick question. I'm an employee right now, and I want to start a business, kind of go on my own. Can you just tell me quickly how to do that? And I said, well, this will require at least a 30 minute to an hour conversation, and I'm going to have to charge. I think I said my hourly rate was $125 an hour. And he basically responded by saying that he can find the information on Google and that it's ridiculous that I would consider charging. So there's going to be clients that have objections, you know, but
you have to sort of learn in a way how to be a salesman. The accountant has to learn to be a salesman. You know, that's it.
Well, I think the big thing here, though, Phil, is that a lot of people undervalue the cost and the true learning that can come from a consultation.
Right. But you have to sort of educate your existing clients and explain to them basically why you must charge for this. It's just now going back to what we were saying, new clients that come on, all right? This is what I provide you. And I do charge for every 15 minutes I speak to you on the phone. And yes, you can derive a lot of revenue from that because you can give them advice on accounting, going over their financial statements, or possibly tax questions, right? They call about tax questions. I always love that. Phil, can you answer a quick tax question? And my answer to that was, I'm really not allowed to answer questions on the phone. That's what I tell them. And also, yeah, that's actually true in a way. Because when someone calls you about a tax question on the phone, you know, there's always that problem that the other person misunderstood what you said.
Mm.
And if they act on that, they're going to, you know, when something happens, like they end up owing the government money, they're going to come back to you and say, you told me this. Now, If you give advice on the phone, what would you recommend to that CPA?
We're not giving that kind of advice. I'm literally just providing a tool that an accountant can use to advise better. That's all. But what I would do is I would make sure to follow up with some kind of written communication. Way it's better for you, better for the client.
Yeah, confirm it in writing. Good. But you never get these questions at all from people who buy the e-learning? Do you have absolutely no contact with these people?
No, we do. Okay. We do. We talk a lot about, you know, sales and marketing. Like you said, that's one of the biggest challenges.
But anyway, no, I actually came to Denver because I bought into an accounting practice. So I was with this guy for 2 months. He did not know how to run a practice. So after about 2 months, I left that practice and I started my own. And I started it with a marketing program that I saw in the Journal of Accountancy. It was a very good marketing program. All right. Now, of course, I went to a marketing course that the AICPA had in Florida. I remember that. And they gave us ideas, you know, get on the radio, do this. But the main thing they said was this, all right, we're going to give you ideas of how to market. And most people don't implement these ideas. Do you find that most people don't implement the marketing ideas?
Not just marketing ideas, but yeah, in general, I think, you know, there's a lot of conferences these days for accountants, accounting professionals, and I was guilty of it myself. You know, I'd go to them and have 20 pages of notes and stars everywhere next to things I was going to do when I'd come back, and then, you know, I'd be all excited and fired up, and then things would get busy. It would be hard to, you know, get it past the team. They wouldn't be as excited because they're not the ones that, you know, had the
That's
idea.
That's true. I was very excited when I came out of there. Yeah. And then you go back where you live and you find out that you lose your excitement.
Mm-hmm.
All right. And, you know, I tried to implement a lot of these things.
But, what were they?
Yeah. Well, try to get on a radio show. And I took a cassette tape and I made a cassette tape talking about something in taxes, you know, and I sent it into a radio station in Denver, and I got a call back, and I ended up on this guy's radio show, and it was KOA radio. I don't know if that's still in effect, but this guy was a shock jock in a way. You know, someone would call him up, he'd insult him. Like one guy called when I was there, and he said, "The tax law is unconstitutional." He says, "I'm not paying my taxes." So this guy Alan Berg said, "Okay, don't pay your taxes. I don't care if you go to jail." All right, then he hangs up on him. But that's the way. And I got a lot of exposure because I was on there for an hour, and then he invited me on for a second hour. I got a couple of clients from that, all right? A couple.
That's great.
Yeah, it was, but I like doing that type of thing.
Absolutely.
All right?
Yeah, it does take to go outside of your comfort zone to talk to people, to talk about things that, yeah, just everybody, you know, I don't want to say everybody, but a lot of people experience imposter syndrome.
So. Yeah. People have trouble. They're afraid of standing in front of people or even talking. All right. But that's a great way if you can do it. It's not as easy as it sounds. I was just very fortunate and lucky that they called me back. You know, most of the times you don't get that. And then they said, write articles and papers, magazines, whatever. But these were the things they came up with. And they all sound great. But, you know, that's assuming a newspaper wants you to write. But we didn't have e-learning back then, you know?
Very true. Well, today, and, you know, there's a lot of different communication ways, right? You can create your own blog. You can create your own podcast.
That's
you
true.
Networking has exploded, right? The culture of networking. So, and e-learning, definitely. That's a giant growing industry because there's only one of you, right? And so you have limited resources. You can't scale. You can only talk to really one person at a time unless you get a group together and you have a class, right? So this is a way for you to make an impact with more people.
And you've been doing this for a year and what, 3 months, 4 months?
Yeah, just about.
And how many people have actually bought into this e-learning system?
Yeah, so we have... Actually, right now we have 11 members. Members are my accounting professionals. And I have 11 small business clients that they have signed underneath them.
Now, what do 11 members pay for this? I'm just curious. Well, tell me how that works. There's 11 members. Does that mean 11 accounting firms?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. And you're willing to disclose what they pay a month? Is that?
I can give you the retail market price.
Okay. Let's get the retail and then the Costco price.
Sure. So they got in because they were founding partners and members. So okay. they got significant discounts that are no longer available. Currently, the price to get in is $10,000 for an onboarding fee, and currently that's discounted.
$10,000 fee, huh? Now, you said the client then pays a license fee too, right?
Mm-hmm, that's right.
Now, these members are CPAs or clients?
My members are mostly accounting professionals.
Okay. Have they been licensing it to their clients?
Yes. So I have 11 small business clients. So it's funny that it's the same member. So the retail value is $10,000, and currently we have a 50% discount for the fall. So it's $5,000, and that's for the onboarding program, just one-time fee. And then there's a monthly fee of $495 a month for 20 licenses. So this allows you to put 20 clients onto the system. And there's a 10% discount currently for that.
Yeah, the 20 clients I would put on a system, that would pay mm-hmm. $495 for,
mm-hmm.
right? Can they then sell it to, if they're in the consulting business, can they sell it to their clients? Can this go all the way down to, your leasing, sublessee, leasee, whatever it is?
So it's not a pyramid scheme. there's only two levels. So if their clients want to become a licensee, a member of the network, then they would just contact the Mastery Network and become a member and have their own clients. But it wouldn't be like the original licensee would get a profit or revenue from the ones below their license, their person they're licensing to.
Now, where is the information? In the cloud?
That's right. It's a website. Yeah.
Well, someone had to write something to get it into the cloud. Am I correct? Who actually came up with this idea? I'm just curious.
Our team writes the content from our experience, from people's knowledge of industries and specific topics. We put it together.
You have a lot of competitors in this business? Is this becoming a very competitive business?
So I think we have a bit of a niche with doing kind of the licensee model that we're working with accounting professionals to support this e-learning. But e-learning, oh my gosh, it's a giant industry.
The big four firms, most of their revenue is coming from advisory services, where it used to come from audits. Are you aware of that?
I was not.
Yeah. And that, I mean, it's interesting. The CPA is, ASCPA wants to treat the CPA as a license, to do audits. Mm-hmm. And yet most of the revenue coming into the big four firms are in consulting advisory services. And I think Price Waterhouse is putting several millions, trillions of dollars into advisory, consulting, artificial intelligence to train their people in that area, because that's the next area. So probably the next 5-10 years, most people in the accounting profession, by the way, they have plenty of notice now. They have to start learning some of these areas.
Absolutely.
Advisory services, artificial intelligence, because if they just say, I'm going to continue to do the bookkeeping work and all that stuff, all right, they're going to have a real problem, because there is a concern that artificial intelligence is going to put a lot of people out of work. Well, it probably will, unless what? You know it's coming. So what do? What would you say?
You pivot now. So yeah, and you're correct. I think I have a statistic here from CPA.com. 80% of accountants think their role will significantly change to higher value strategic advisory by 2025. And I think I heard a statistic that was similar that said something like 80% of your revenue should come from that as well.
That would be great. You want to know why? Because, the thing that killed a lot of practices, CPA practices in Denver at the time, was the fact that you had these non-CPAs and they were going and giving the same services, write-up work, mm-hmm. for like, half the price. Yeah. So now, if that happens, what you just said, all right, then CPAs, they will have that expertise that these bookkeeping services will not. That's the way I look at it. What do you
Absolutely.
Think?
Absolutely. Well, it's strategy, right? So you understand as a CPA or as an accounting professional who understands financial statements and tax law, right? You understand strategy. You understand what it means to look at these numbers and how the laws change and how you can kind of create a whole plan around it, right? As an accounting professional, you also probably have a network of other advisors that you talk to. You should, if you don't. Like, you should know financial planners, or advisors. You should know attorneys, marketing professionals, sales professionals, coaches who can help with soft skills. So that's part of our business. It's kind of the network piece of the Mastery Network, is you building your internal network. So that when your client says, I'm having a hard time with revenue, I'm not pulling in the money that I want, you as an accountant can say, well, what do the numbers say? And you could say, perhaps your price is not where it should be. right? So it might be as easy as raising the price. However, you might need some marketing and sales help now, because before you were charging $10, now you want to charge $20. How are you going to sell, you know, 100% increase in your fees, in your costs? So, and then the accountant can say, I have a person you can talk to, so that the person who you're advising is not left with just, well, what do I do now? I guess I got to go find a salesperson now, right? So
that you don't charge for that, referring a marketing person to a client on the e-learning system, do you?
We don't currently have that network, but we are building it. So I'm encouraging my members to build their own network locally, because usually clients want someone local. So, but I do envision that we will have advisors who we can refer to if the
accountants. Advisors probably should send you business. Don't you think so?
Well, only if the advisor wants to build that kind of model in their business, you know?
Well, if they send you referrals, what are you going to do? You're going to pay them a referral fee, or, you know, you're just going to, you know, say thank you very much, and, you know, I appreciate the business?
Yeah, currently our founding partners and members, we have a commission referral structure for them. Yeah.
Where are your founding fathers? Are they in Colorado?
All over the United States.
You've done all of this? This is amazing. Have you put all this together? How many people have put this thing together?
Not just me.
How many people put this whole idea together?
So there is four of us to begin with. And one of my business partners is actually my old boss. So the small firm that I told you about earlier, he was the one that hired me into that small company. And then he sold the accounting firm last year and we started this business.
Do you network yourself with people in the advisory community to learn things from them? Is that what you do? Or you just read books? Where do you learn this stuff?
Yeah. So, I mean, our members have a very diverse, or partners rather, have a very diverse set of skills and backgrounds. So I'm able to pull a lot of information from them. And a lot of it, you know, the learning that I'm currently building, the Core 24 program, is just basic stuff. I'm not reinventing the wheel. I'm not putting anything in there that's like, oh my gosh, Alina is the first person to have said this ever. No, I'm not. So I just want to bring information that I've learned from advising small business owners and what they've run into, and my business partners too. So, like for example, real estate, right? I've never owned or leased commercial real estate, but one of my business partners does. So he was able to provide a lot of insight on that.
What about universities? Have you ever tried with this possibility getting these programs into universities?
I think that would be awesome. And it's one of the vertical markets that we've looked at. Yeah. I think that, you know, formal education, it can be hard to step in and kind of break a pattern, change up the system. I think a lot of, you know, that think tank that I told you about, we had a couple of educators in there talking about just how it's difficult to change up the curriculum. Because they were talking about, well, now that the accounting industry is shifting, shouldn't we be focusing on different topics in school? Right.
Yeah. Stuff with artificial intelligence, you know?
Yeah. And they were just talking about how hard it is to change it up.
A lot of stuff is computer courses that these people are taking. You know, that's what they use for the artificial intelligence. But I was talking to someone from Chicago and I said, how'd you get into this artificial intelligence? She says she takes courses at the university on computers, that type of thing. Although there's not necessarily a designated program called artificial intelligence. But, you know, that's a pretty sophisticated university. And I'm wondering, with all this stuff coming out, you know, how are the people graduating college going to learn this stuff to be really good advisors?
Yeah, that's interesting. You know, the younger people do have an advantage that they have probably grown up with technology their entire life. Technology, I mean, like computers and up, right? 1981 and going up. So they do adapt to technology easier. People today adapt to technology at astronomical numbers. I'm actually just building the module for technology in my program. And I think I said, let's see, what's the statistic over here? So it took 50 years for 50 million people to adopt the telephone, but it took 3 years for 50 million people to adopt Facebook and 19 days for 50 million people to adopt Pokemon Go.
I'm sorry. What is that? What is Pokemon? I really don't know. Is that a game or?
It is. It's a game on your phone where you go and find little mythical creatures that are called Pokemon.
Well, I'm glad we have that last statistic of how many.
My point is, it's technology is being adopted a lot faster. It's becoming more user-friendly. It's becoming easier to use. So although there may not be formal courses in, like you said, artificial intelligence, I do think that younger people are just more curious, more comfortable with technology. So,
and also, as I said, the big four firms are spending a lot of money. They're going to educate the people they hire.
That's right. And they're also hiring people that are not accountants.
Yes, that's true. In fact, not a CPA firm, but I had someone on here. She has a degree in sociology, and she's doing things in programming and not programming, performance work. What do they call that? I'm not sure what they use. She will go into a firm and determine how the employees are performing, all right, and makes recommendations, on that. And, when I graduated school, if you had a degree in sociology, all right, when you graduated, you would be out of work, actually. You had to be specific, like accountancy, law, that type of thing. But now they're looking for liberal arts people. I think they feel they're more, have a better background overall, where maybe we're too specialized as accountants. I don't know. But no, it's nice to know that they're going to people. Yeah, they're not CPAs. And she can't take the CPA exam because she didn't graduate accounting. So it'll be interesting to see where this whole system goes into, where accountants will be in 5-10 years. And the question will be this: will people want to still take the CPA exam? What do you think?
That is interesting. I do think the exam needs to evolve to kind of grow with the industry, right? Grow with the shifts. So, I mean, I think that there's already I've listened to your other episodes. You said something that was very interesting. Did you say 50% less of people?
Over the last 10 years, has it been a decrease of at least 50% of the people? Number of people taking exams has been decreased by about 50%.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it's only because of the 150 hours didn't help. Mm. And also people are, they're finding they don't, the experience requirements are very difficult.
Yeah.
Not just working in accounting. You have to work under a CPA or have
the barrier to entry.
That really, yeah. And also we're losing all the foreign market too. We're not getting a lot of people from foreign markets who want to become CPAs because it's a problem getting the licensing. Mm-hmm. So you know what they're taking? CMA, but that is a problem. And we discussed that. Mike, I don't know if I discussed that with Mike Decker, who was on, Director of Examinations, but that comes up all the time when we meet twice a year.
Yeah.
He says, any suggestion on how we can increase the number of people taking the exam? And whatever suggestion you come up with, he'll say, that can't be done.
Huh.
All right. We need all the state boards to agree. We need NASBA to agree. It's too many organizations.
Well, and the other part of it is how people look at the designation, right? So I think that the designation held a lot of respect. I mean, it still does. But I've just noticed that younger people don't seem to care as much. If I have a client today who's 18 years old, and I have a client who's, I don't know, above 40, the 18-year-old client may not care that I have my CPA. Do you see what I'm saying?
Oh, yeah, definitely. Should you blame the AICPA for not marketing that more to that, high school students maybe go in there, point out why is the value becoming a CPA? There's too many people involved in these decision processes with the CPA exam. Yeah.
Yeah. I think the issue goes very, very deep. Like there's a lot of different branches of, you could make one argument and then have 10 counter arguments that say, but what if?
Oh, right. Yeah, that's always the thing. What if? You're absolutely right. But anyway, I certainly wish you the best with the Mastery Network. You're a nice person. I mean that. I know I joke around, but I really do mean that. And I know what it's like to be in business because I was in business for so many years. I'm still in it. But, I think you have that entrepreneur mentality. You really do.
Thanks.
And I do wish you the best with this, Mastery Network. And we'll have to talk again. I'm interested to find out maybe another time how you're doing with this.
Absolutely. If you are in the accounting industry and you care about the future of your practice and your firm, you want to stay relevant through the next 10 to 20 to 30 years, even if you're exiting the industry, but you may have people that you can either pass on the practice to or sell for top dollar, then you should consider, heavily consider pivoting to provide more advisory services and consulting services to your clients. So I have a solution through the Mastery Network that will allow you to do that by providing e-learning to your clients so that they can learn basic concepts and ask you really good questions, which will lead to more advisory. So I would just encourage people to kind of be aware of what's happening in the industry and kind of not get left behind.
How would someone get a hold of you if they were interested in this?
Yeah. So we have a website, themastery.network. You can also email me at info@themastery.network. Or you can find just me personally on LinkedIn. Just search Alina Nikishina and reach out with a message.
Best of luck with everything. Thank you for putting up with me. That in itself, you deserve a medal. All right. And we'll get you one of those additional year medals for being a great influencer, because you influence people to watch me. I don't know if you did or not. But anyway, Rob, I'm going to let you take over the show. Go ahead, Rob. Thank you.
Once again, I'd like to thank you for being the best part of CPA Review and More with your host, Phil Yeager. If you have any questions or topics you'd like to hear on the show, or if you'd like to be a guest on the show to share your story, we want to hear from you. Send me an email to the studio at podcast@YeagerCPAReview.com. If you're enjoying the content that we're providing, we'd greatly appreciate it if you'd submit a review to the Apple iTunes podcast app to let us know how we're doing. If you're in the market for a CPA review course or simply want to find out more about the CPA exam and what Yeager has to offer, check out YeagerCPAReview.com or call our office and we'll answer any questions you may have. The link and the phone number will be in the description of this podcast. Here at Team Yeager, we're excited to tell you about our new Yeager CPA Review subscription format. It's the same great Yeager CPA Review course that you know and love on an all-new month-to-month, no-commitment subscription format. Check it out today. Once again, my name's Rob Medford. I'm your executive producer and director here at the Yeager Studios. And until next time, take care and be audit you can be.